Greetings, my name is Mars, and I welcome you to my little hole in the Underdark. Have you ever wanted to learn about the units of Fire Emblem, but didn't want any of that silly nuance or credibility? Then you've come to the right place. Tonight, I will be telling you about the Lords. Let's begin. The Lord, or Lords, in any Fire Emblem game is the head of your army. While the names and roles may change from game to game, there are usually a few connecting strings between each Lord. They are usually from a noble house of some kind. They have a tendency to use swords for most of their adventure. They don't promote until the late game. This can vary from the third act to literally right before the end of the game. Fuck you, Roy! And if they die, then it's game over for you, so don't let that happen. Anyway, enough with the pretenses. It's time I showed off some of the more notable lords of this series. And because I want to keep this fairly brief, I'm only going to be focusing on the ones that actually matter. And also Sigurd, because Mila knows that the hardcore fans would beat me with sticks if I left him out. The best place to start with this little skim over would be with everyone's favorite royal thought, the Atlian Prince Marth. This precious blue boy is notable for several reasons. He's the first lord in the series, he started the trend of lords beginning their adventures with a personal weapon, as well as beginning with swords, he's had the most appearances of any lord in the series, and he can't promote because reasons. But hey, he can level up to 30 instead of 20. Hooray! And finally, he's the first lord to wield the legendary blade Falchion, which looks nothing like an actual falchion because of course it doesn't. Second lord in our chopping block is Sigurd, the main character of the first half of Fire Emblem 4, Genealogy of the Holy War. Sigurd shook up things quite a bit for the series. For starters, he has his ass glued to a horse instead of being on foot for the whole game. This is a feature that will become immediately helpful upon your realization that this is Fire Emblem 4 and the maps are fucking massive. Sigurd is more than just a pretty face with good movement. His bases are incredible, and unlike the lords before him, Sigurd isn't locked to using swords. Praise be! No, this absolute unit is proficient in both swords and lances, giving him access to two-thirds of the weapon triangle. I'd usually go into the plot of Fire Emblem 4 and Sigurd's character, but this is meant to be a quick summary and not an analytical look at genealogy. And I'd also like to avoid spoilers for one of the best plots in the series, so let's move on to greener, less incinerated pastures. Next up is everyone's favorite fiery boy, Roy, son of Marquis Elowood of Perret. Roy is the young leader of the Lycian League, taking up the mantle when he was just 15 years old. And boy howdy, does Roy have the stats of a 15-year-old. I'm not going to beat around the bush, Roy's base stats and growth can only be described as underwhelming. He also doesn't promote until incredibly late into the game, meaning from the point you get him to level 20 and up until then, letting him land kills is just wasted experience points. It's a bit of an annoyance, to be honest. But hey, once he does promote, Roy finally proves why he's our boy. The next in line is Ike, leader of the Grail Mercenary Band and hero of the Korean War. Ike is one of the few lords in the series whose story didn't wrap up in just one game, but instead two. Path of Radiance and its sequel, Radiant Dawn. It should be noted that while Ike is technically not called a lord, he is still functionally one in both games that he is the main character of. Stat-wise, Ike is perfectly decent. Though being locked with swords is quite problematic, especially in Path of Radiance when he doesn't have access to a range option until very late into the game. His character is also quite enjoyable, though more so in Path of Radiance when he has more time to develop. All in all, while I think he has some issues, I quite like Ike. Now, I can't get this going on from Eternity, so I'll be combining Crom, Lucina, and Robin into the same summary as they are all from Fire Emblem Awakening. Crom is the Prince of Elise and the younger brother of the current Exile, Imran. He, like several lords before him, uses the unmatched blade Falchion, meaning he is once again sword-locked. Fantastic! Robin, on the other hand, is not bound by such a restriction. Working as Crom's trusted tactician, this doesn't mean that Robin hides in a tent all day until the battle is over. Nope, they're on the front lines using both swords and magic to destroy their foes. And the third of this trio is Lucina, Crom's daughter. Yet another sword-locked wielder of Falchion, Lucina came from the future to prevent the fall of the civilized world to a terrible catastrophe and to prevent her own father's demise. And to also pour a quiver she slash the player fancies, because why not? And last, and certainly least, we have Corrin. Oh, that we do. Corrin was born of the Kingdom of Hoshido, raised by the rival land of Nor, and is the biggest. Marty Stewart is a very contentious character within the fan base, due to in large part the problematic writing of Fates. This problematic writing either makes them a wishy-washy loser in Conquest, or so bloodthirsty for Norian skulls do you think they were a Black Templar in Birthright. However, at the very least, they are quite a good unit on the battlefield, being blessed with both good bases and growths, as well as being able to use a dragonstone to turn into a dragon, as useless as that might be. So congratulations, Korn. You might have the personality of a plank of wood, but you can kill shit good. And that'll about do it. I do hope you all enjoyed this little thing I put together. It's my first attempt to make a video like this. Hopefully I'll have your company in my little hole in the Underdark next time.